creating comprehensive lesson plans. I think creating of lesson plans is one of the most important aspect of classroom teaching. Before we actually go to the class, we need to plan our lessons so that our plan is successful. What we intend to achieve in our classroom is achieved. So there's a difference in the objective and the outcome, right? So when we are So when there is an objective, we try to achieve the goal. If there are no objectives, then we get into the class and we try random things which may or may not work. So this session is how to create comprehensive lesson plans, some basic steps that we need to follow. Because time and again, I think most schools intend on submissions. As per the new national education policy, there has to be certain parameters involved in the designing of the lesson plan. And also it is important that we are generating a lesson plan in such a manner that it is practical, we can implement it, and the students benefit out of it. So the first thing is the lesson title. What are we intending to provide to the student? That lesson title has to come, and it has to be a very concise and descriptive title. The title should not be very long. Somebody who is reading the lesson plan should understand by reading the topic that what is intended to be covered in that particular class or classes. So the lesson title has to be there. That's the first and foremost thing, along with the date, of course, and the class that you are teaching. That's very, very important. So which level are you teaching? Are you teaching class 6 or 7 or 8, 9, 10? It doesn't matter. Lesson plan format is more or less the same. So we need to indicate our subject, which grade that we are teaching. And I think that's the introduction. And you've been following the Bloom's taxonomy. All those parameters need to be there. So the title, the grade, the subject, these are basics. The learning objectives. Now, what is the meaning of a learning objective? Objective is that what do you intend to do? So it may or may not be achieved, but what is the intention of the teacher to go into the class and teach what? So are we going to the class to teach some conceptual thing, or is it a repetition, recall, or are we allowing the students to imagine a situation? So all that objective or the goal for the lesson has to be very, very clear. So irrespective of the subject, we need to have a goal. Without the goal, learning objective, the lesson is actually waste. So when we are going to the class, there has to be objective. Okay, by the end of this chapter, the student should be able to do this, 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 ABC, right? So this is the objective. And whenever we are planning the objectives or writing the objectives, please remember that it should be measurable. It should not be infinite, and it should not be not defined. Something which is defined, that means at the end of the class, that the student should know, write down these 2, 3 points or 4 points or 5 points. So it should be measurable that when I'm taking a test, will I be able to get the answer to the objective? Will the objective be achieved or not? I need to find that out. So it should be measurable and aligned with the curriculum standard. So that is very important, because if you are having an objective which is much beyond the level or much below the level of the class that you are taking, then again, the purpose of the lesson is defeated. So it's important that whichever grade we are teaching, the learning objective should be measurable and aligned with the curriculum standards. So depending on the region that you are, depending on the syllabus that you follow, the curriculum that you follow, it is important that it is measurable and aligned with that. You should not set objectives which are beyond or below the expectations. So what happens otherwise is that it's going to create a chaos, and the lesson plan's objective may not be achieved. Now, prior knowledge assessment. Always it's important that when we are going into the class, what before introducing a topic, it's important that what do they know? Because, you know, many of us assume that the students have already done these things in the previous classes, that we don't introduce the topic from the basics. So what happens is that in the assumption that we go on, and already the student may not be knowing certain things, and then we are teaching new things. So what happens is that again, the learning gap occurs. So it's important to assess the prior knowledge of the students, because unless we have the prior knowledge, The continuity will not be. Of course, if you're teaching a new topic, it is not relevant. But I'm talking in case of new topics, whenever we are introducing some topic which is already done in the previous classes and we are continuing with that, then the assessing the prior knowledge or the previous understanding is very important. So this will help us to get a starting point. Okay, this is what my class knows. So where should I start this from? Should I repeat certain stuff which they have done in the previous classes, or should I go ahead? So once we get there, then our instruction can be tailored accordingly. And if the class becomes more meaningful, otherwise we are talking, you know, French and Greek or some other language and they are not able to understand that. So this is important that we assess the prior knowledge, and the objective becomes more defined when we are going to go to the level of the student and then continue our lesson. So materials and resources. So we need to write down actually what are we going to use. Are we going to use some teaching aid? Are we using a smart board? Are you using charts? Are we going to use some models? Are we going to do some art integration activities? So what resources and materials are we including in the lesson? So all the material and resources needed, textbooks, worksheets, assignments, you know, the multimedia resources, the manipulatives that you're using, and as I said, the models or the charts, or you are having a live demo of something, then all these material and resources need to be recorded. It's important that we record this so that the intended objectives are achieved. So materials and resources used is an important part of the lesson plan. Then of course comes the methodology. How will you introduce the lesson? Now this is the most important part. Whenever we go to a class and introduce a topic, that sets the tone for the next few classes. So if your introduction is not good enough, not encouraging or strong enough, then the whole next 5-6 classes which will follow on that topic is going to suffer, because the introduction was weak. The student did not understand what the chapter is all about, and we are going on to. So it's important that we start with something which they already know, connected to real life examples, and then start with questions. We need to ask more questions. When we ask more questions, then only we are going to engage them. Otherwise, it becomes the lecture method, which has been, you know, the teacher-centric method. We are talking about decades-old methodologies. So when we are talking about the new methodology, when we are making use of AI, when you're making use of smart boards, and of course, child-centric education, it has to be a two-way process. We need to ask questions to extract information from the kids, and we need to encourage the child to ask us questions. So the methodology should be very simple, that our lesson should be able to capture the imagination and attention of the students. It should be very relevant. And the relevance comes by hooking up the text or the problems or whatever is the content that you are teaching with the real life. So whenever I'm talking about democracy, I need to connect it to a democratic institution or a democratic country and explain, okay, this is what happens. Give them examples of autocracy. If I'm talking about mathematics, I need to give real life examples. When I'm taking trigonometry or any chapter, it's important, the real life example, because without real life examples, there is no connection. So methodology is important. How are we going to introduce the chapter? And of course, once the introduction is good and the methodology is designed, the lesson plan follows. Then comes the instructional sequence. Okay, what happens? What happens one after the other? What am I going to do in this whole lesson? So introduction is there. A recapitulation of previous facts, that is there. So we have to introduce the chapter step by step, you know, like an algorithm. When we write programs, we write algorithms. So there has to be a step-by-step sequence, instructional strategies that will be followed in completion of the chapter. So how will we cover this content? So will there be group work? Will there be discussions? Will there be assignments? Will there be projects? Will there be activities? All this need to be decided. So hands-on activities are always welcome whenever possible, because, you know, learning by doing or experiential learning is going to give us more benefit. So any relevant method that you are using, any different method that you are using to cover the content, you have to write down in the sequence, and that provides, the lesson plan becomes very meaningful. And of course, the children will get benefited by whatever sequence that you are preparing. Then, of course, this is also, we have time and again said that differentiation. So there are lots and lots of students who will require differential teaching methods because they are not, able to understand, or there may be geniuses. So there is differential learning. And then what happens when there is diverse learning? Probably there is a language barrier, there is a communication barrier, age barrier. Some are coming from rural areas and some are coming from urban areas. So, depending on your school, there may be various challenges that you're facing. So how are we going to include those? What are the strategies? Are we having remedial classes? Are we having extra classes? Are we giving additional worksheets for the high IQ students? Are we preparing them for, Olympiads or some other extracurricular activities besides the curriculum? So all this is the extension of the lesson plan. Lesson plan should also include what we are doing for the gifted students and the weak students and what strategies we are doing. So the general lesson plan, of course, is what the majority is doing. But there will be some aspect where we have to discuss what we are doing for the weaker students, those who are not able to cope up with the class. And also, what are we doing about the high IQ students? Because they get bored by the normal teaching. We need to keep them engaged. We need to challenge them more so that, their brain is put to maximum use and they come up to their potential. So it's important that we accommodate all the, our learners in our class. We cannot differentiate, this section is the A graders and these are the B graders. We can't do that. Many schools are doing it, but at the same time, majority of the schools don't advocate it. Psychologists don't advocate it. So what happens is that we need to accommodate every type of learner in our classes. So how are we doing it? We need to record that as part of the lesson plan. Then, of course, when we have taught it, we need to make an assessment. Assessments help you to judge whether what you have done has bore fruit or not. So that's your outcome. So assessment, what we have taken a test based on this and what happened in those. So you can create a database like, okay, so many students got so many marks, so many students got below 33 marks, so many got above 90. And then what happens is that you get an idea of how effective your lessons were and what are we going to do. Otherwise, what will happen? We keep on going one after the other, and without assessments, we are not able to judge how much the student has absorbed. So there has to be an assessment. The assessment, we have formative assessment, summative assessment. You can take quizzes, you can do oral questioning, there can be projects, there can be crosswords, there can be multiple ways of assessing. Multiple assessment is part of our assessment in the internals. So multiple assessments can be done. It's not necessarily a paper pen test. So if it is not possible to conduct a paper pen test, we can have a quiz, we can have a discussion on the basis of which we can judge whether students have actually understood. So recently, we had some trainees in our school and they were, they put in their best and they were thinking that they've done a very good job. And then when they took a test after they taught for about 10 days, one of them very sadly came to me and said, sir, 80% of the students have got actually zero. So I told her that, see, this is what happens. This is the challenge of a teacher. We think that we have done a great job, but when it has come to the test part, they have not done. So what you see, you should not believe. They will say that they have understood, but actually they may not have understood or they may not have practiced. So there are a lot of challenges of repeating, of dealing with different kind of students. So I said, don't worry. This is a part of the training. You will now understand that everything that you are saying is not absorbed by the student. So we need to try out various strategies. So that's what experience teaches us. And that's how we become experts. So the more experience that we have, the more learning that we have, the more better we become. And we try to devise new methods and we try to learn from others always. So this is what happens. And this is a very important part of the plan, lesson plan. And especially in the learning outcome part, the assessments. Then we come to the closure that after we have the learning outcome, the assessment part, we have understood what we have planned has been actually implemented, yes, but what is the outcome of that? So there has to be a reflection, there has to be some remarks. Okay, so how are we going to close? We'll summarize the key points under remarks or something like that. And we will allow also the students to reflect on their learning. So there has to be a collaborative effort in reflecting on the whole lesson plan. So then we can include some home assignments, you know, homework, what is the homework that we have given, what is the follow-up activities or tasks for further reflection. And I think we'll be able to create a beautiful lesson plan. So homeworks or independent practice or group work, as CBSE is suggesting now, include group work also. So we can specify all that, and the student will complete these tasks after every lesson so that we come to know. So homework is a very important part of our lesson, and also the assessments that we are taking is also a part of this. So it's not only the lecture that we are taking in the class, but we need this multiple sources of feedback of how effective our lessons were. And of course, it will be very sad if teachers of today don't integrate technology. Especially after the COVID, many, many teachers have learned a lot of technology and are still learning. Every day we are learning something new. And we are going to integrate this technology into our classrooms to make our lessons more meaningful so that the experience becomes more better as compared to, you know, chalk and blackboard, which we've been using for n number of years. We use technology, we send them videos, we send them relevant resources. We send them quiz. So there can be multiple ways of making a class interesting. So integration of technology, how we have integrated this can also be part of this. And all this, of course, has to be timed. And okay, so your lesson plan, this lesson is long or short. Depending on that, you have to allot this many number of periods. Each period's duration should be there. So a time frame should be there. Otherwise, you know, the curriculum doesn't get completed. So we should not, you know, stick on to one lesson and go on and on forever on that. So it's important that we plan all this in advance so that there is no problem as far as completion of the course is concerned. So the time frame is important, and it has to be a realistic, well-paced instruction plan. So time management is very important. Otherwise, we have seen many teachers who are not able to complete the course. And then towards the end, they rush a lot of chapters. So from at the beginning of the year, we say, okay, these are the chapters we need to finish by the end of this month. So your lesson plan should be divided accordingly. Then accompanying worksheet. You can paste the worksheets that you are giving to your students, the handouts that you are giving. All this copy can be pasted in your chronicles, so that we get an idea of how the worksheet is improving the quality of the work that is being submitted by the students. And it also becomes a record for the coming years. So whatever material that we have prepared for this year will also become relevant, and we can improve upon that. So the assignment that you prepare this year should not go waste. We can improve upon it next year and give it out. And these handouts and resources will be used during the lesson. So all this can be recorded. And then, of course, the reflections, as I said, we can, after the lesson is over, we can make a note, and for personal improvement and for future, we can note down that what went wrong, what went right, and if there were any fruitful discussions in the class, that can be noted in the remarks. And the reflection that the student shared, the parent shared in probably a parent-teacher meeting, all this can also be part of our lesson plan. So this is a general framework. So what I'm going to do right now is show you a format of a lesson plan, which can be generated through AI, because many of us are writing this, but at the same time, they don't get time probably to get new ideas, incorporate new ideas. So with the, as I said, technology is very important in the life of a teacher right now. So if we don't incorporate AI, I think we are not doing justice. So we are going to generate a sample lesson plan. So I'm going to generate for you two lesson plans, let's say, and you will be able to generate it very easily. So I'm going to demonstrate to you how we can generate this. And of course, as per your school and location, we can, and subject, you can modify it as per your needs. So what I'm going to do is show this how it is done. So what has to be done is you can take your normal Google Chrome, right? And we can generate it. So I'm showing you a sample of how a lesson plan can be generated through AI. So what we need is to just write lesson plan generator. And there are many AI apps. I am showing the Vercel app. So V-E-R-C-E-L, lesson plan generator, Vercel app. I'm just using this. So you get this here, lesson plan generator. As I said, V-E-R-C-E-L, V-E-R-C-E-L. There may be many others. So once we click on that, we get this page, lesson plan generator. Here we have the grade. So let me just show you one sample of, let's say, 10th. And then I need to choose my subject, whether it's math, science, or whatever. So I'm showing you one for maths. The topic that we intend to write, the lesson plan that I'm going to write. So for example, I'm going to do, let's say, trigonometry. I have trigonometry. And then the Bloom verb selection. So your lesson plan is based on what? So let's say we are introducing the chapter. So I'm going to do recall. And then I need to put my email ID here. And that's it. We are good to go. And you will be surprised that you are able to generate this lesson plan in a few seconds. In a few seconds. And the ideas are very, very good. So here I've got my lesson plan ready here. Okay, the lesson objectives is to recall the concepts of trigonometry. The opening lines, that is the introduction, is there. So how is it used in real life? As I said, we need to connect to real life. So understanding, so use. So it is used in measuring heights and buildings, heights of buildings, calculating distance, estimating angles. It is used in architecture, engineering, navigation. So real life, where is this applicable, is there. And then the introduction is there. So introduction to the concept of trigonometry is there. Then the guided practice, how we have to help the students to practice the lesson objective. Okay, so giving problem tasks, making small groups, utilizing online resources. Independent practice, you know, they have given a few sums which the students can do. And then the closing remarks. So this is a sample lesson plan. As I said, this is just a sample. It can be, you have to generate as per your class subject. And of course, you can modify it because this is not a perfect thing. So let's say we are doing something for another subject, let's say science. So here we have science. And let's say we are introducing something on chemistry, let's say chemical reactions. So we have chemical reactions, right? And here we have the Bloom verb cell. Let's say we need to classify. And then we've already added the email address and we'll generate the lesson plan. And as I said, in a few seconds, we'll be able to generate this. So it has been generated here, the chemical reaction. Start the class with a short video clip demonstrating chemical reaction. So it's giving you an idea that instead of you giving a lecture, start with a video demonstration. Of course, you are free to do it or not, and you are free to add your own ideas. Then, of course, the relevance. How is chemical reaction important in our daily lives? We are doing it in cooking, cleaning, medication. Okay, all this is the relevance. So this is a very important aspect of our lesson plan, that introduce the relevance of that topic, why we are doing it and how we are doing it and how they can use it. Then the new material. So there are different type of reactions they have explained, combination, decomposition, displacement, and so on. Okay, there is how to engage the students. They have given some ideas. Ask the students to write down their observations when vinegar and baking soda is reacting. Then conduct simple experiments in the class. Make them do some stuff, experiments in the labs probably. And ask the students to share real life examples of chemical reactions they have observed or experienced. Then guided practice, a few reactions are given which they have to write down. There's a group activity given. There is independent practice. Some questions are given. And and a lot of ideas are given. So this is how it can be generated. There's a time given there. Opening 5 minutes. Introduction to the new material 15. Guided practice 15. Independent 5. And closing 5. So they've divided even the subtopics into times. So this is about 45 minutes. 45, 30. Yeah, 45 minutes lesson plan. So if your school is having 40 minutes or 35 minutes, then accordingly we can plan. So this is a very good app which I have seen. It's a lesson plan generated by Vercel, and you can generate all classes from 1 to 10 as of now. 11th and 12th, I believe they are working on it, and you will be expecting it in a month or so. And mostly all the subjects are already uploaded, not uploaded, it's AI generated. So you'll be able to get the subjects here and the output. And obviously you are going to get a lot of ideas from this, especially the part on the relevance of the topic in real life. And of course, a lot of ideas on how to implement the lesson plan, or the what are you planning for the students, and different strategies that you're going to use to teach that lesson. So I hope this session was effective. Thank you.